Whoa.
Hey guys, I'm here. Let's get technical. Check this out. This blew my mind. With me, I have a hot plate, some water, a pipette, and, of course, safety glasses. Huge shout out to NoCry for sending me a pair and sponsoring this episode. If I take some water and put it on this hot plate, which is turned off and completely cool, check out what happens. Pretty typical. But check out what happens if I take some water and put it on this hot plate. Whoa, that is so cool. Actually, I guess it's hot.
Not to mention, the other day, I was just standing around, minding my own business, holding a ladle of liquid nitrogen, you know, the usual, when I found out that Vsauce had uploaded a video.
Huh. Which way is down?
Excited, I ran to find my computer and start watching, but in the process, I spilled my ladle of liquid nitrogen. At first, I freaked out, because, you know, I really like my ladle of liquid nitrogen. But then I saw something cool. When I spilled liquid nitrogen, it didn't just make a puddle in a big old mess like water would. It balled up and the balls rolled around.
Whoa, what's going on here? I'll tell you after the wipe.
That is the Leidenfrost effect. How does it work? Well, to answer that, let's take a look at what I thought the first time I saw the Leidenfrost effect.
Wow, that's amazing. But wait a sec, this can't happen every time, right? Like, I've seen water boil.
And I was right. The hot pad with the Leidenfrost effect was at a balmy 220 degrees Celsius, or 428 degrees Fahrenheit. Let's see what happens if I bring that temperature down a bit, say to 200 degrees Celsius.
It boils and evaporates just like normal. This is a huge clue as to how the Leidenfrost effect works.
See, we all know that when water gets hot enough, it turns into steam. And the hotter a substance is, the quicker water will evaporate when put on it. So, what if we had a surface that was so hot that the instant water hit it, it turned into steam? That is how the Leidenfrost effect works. The moment the water hits that hot plate, a little bit of it evaporates and turns into steam. This creates a sort of cushion for the water, a layer of steam between the water and the hot plate. Why? As we discussed in a previous video, which I strongly recommend you check out, click the I, heat is just a measurement of how fast molecules in a thing are moving. The way things change temperature is they come into contact with either faster or slower molecules. All of the molecules bump into each other, and if the end result is the original substance having faster molecules, then the substance just became hotter, and if the end result is the original substance having slower molecules, then the substance just became colder. If molecules move fast enough, a substance will undergo a phase change. Gases have faster moving molecules than liquids, and liquids have faster moving molecules than solids. That's the skinny, back to the Leidenfrost effect. When each drop of water hits the plate and a little bit of it evaporates, it creates a layer of steam. Because the molecules in the water vapor move faster than molecules in the water, they end up hitting the water, bouncing into it, some escaping from the edges, making a sort of smooth crescent-like shape. This is called film boiling.
Hey, does anyone have a Kodak?
No, not that type of film. And it's because that layer of water vapor insulates the water droplet so well, it just levitates around and doesn't boil. Mind blown. But wait a second, just wait a second. Heh, puns. Does that water just stay in beadlets and fly around forever? I mean, it has to evaporate at some point, right? Yeah, it does. If you just kind of leave the drop of water there, eventually it will go away, but it'll go away very slowly. This is because air is great for insulating stuff. To prove it, I am now wearing a wetsuit. I wear this thing whenever I go surfing, and a lot of other people who engage in beachy activities and want to stay warm do too. SciShow has a great video on how wetsuits work, but the important thing to know here is that wetsuits really are wet. There's a layer of water in them. Now, water is pretty good at insulation and has a thermal conductivity of 0.58 watts per meter Kelvin, but you know what's better at insulation than water? Air. That's why, when Destin of Smarter Every Day went diving in the frigid waters of Silfur Iceland with his wife, they wore dry suits and not wetsuits, because air has a lower thermal conductivity than water, thus making it better at insulation and keeping people warmer. I'm gonna take this off now. That's why water droplets on the hot plate take so long to evaporate. Air is just that bad at transferring heat. Speaking of air and insulation, have you ever looked at a pot of 385 degrees Celsius molten lead and thought to yourself, hey, I really want to put my hand in there? Well, now you can, thanks to the Leidenfrost effect. Disclaimer, please, for the love of all that is holy, do not try this at home. Because the Mythbusters already tried it. Yup, as long as you wet your hand before you put it in, the Leidenfrost effect will kick in and form a sort of glove of air around your hand, thus making it, for a short amount of time, completely protected.
One human hand in molten metal. Ho 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 ho! That's freaky. You can feel the water boiling against your fingers. You can feel that right there.
Except, once again, do not try that yourself. It looks really cool, but they are professionals.
Don't be stupid!
The Leidenfrost effect is named after Johann Gottlob Leidenfrost, an 18th century German doctor who first wrote about the effect in his paper A Tract About Some Qualities of Common Water in 1756. In this English translation I found, the paper starts off with, quote, "To the most illustrious Royal Academy of Scientists in Berlin, John G. Leidenfrost offers his reverence and wishes you health." So he must really like check those guys. Along with the line frost effect, Mr. Line Frost also gave us the concept of the line frost point, which is the coolest temperature a surface needs to be for a certain substance to achieve the line frost effect. The line frost point can be derived from Zuber's equation, but that is way too long and complicated to go into here, so let's fast forward a bit. Basically, all you need to know is that the line frost point changes depending on what substance you're talking about. For water, it's about 220 degrees Celsius, but for liquid nitrogen, the temperature of the floor is hot enough. That's why, going back to one of our first examples, you can spill liquid nitrogen on the floor and see the line frost effect. You know, it's pretty hard to get those droplets to stay in just one place, whether they be water or liquid nitrogen. And that's because the layer of gas between the droplets and the floor is, as one study puts it, virtually frictionless. But what does that mean? Okay, so there are two kinds of friction, static friction and kinetic friction. Think of it like this. Imagine I'm trying to push this copy of Turtles all the way down. Now, is it actually going to move if I just lightly press on it? No, of course not. But will it actually move if I press a bit harder? Yeah. So naturally, you've got to wonder how much force do you have to put into Turtles all the way down, or Taued, to get it to start moving. That is static friction. Kinetic friction is the force acting against Taued when it's in motion, making it a little harder for me to continue to push. Lucky for us, and scientists, water droplets levitating because of the line frost effect have a very low static friction and kinetic friction. That means you don't need too much to get those droplets going, you'll see that even the tiniest nudge makes them go crazy, but also, when they start going, it's not easy for a droplet to stop. Matter of fact, it's possible for them to travel a full meter, if not further, under the proper conditions. And when friction is out of the equation, liquids can move in some pretty cool ways. Undergraduate students Carmen Chang and Matthew Guy at the University of Bath over in England found that if you put water droplets on a hot, serrated surface, the line frost effect propels them in a certain direction. You can even make them climb up hill or travel a maze, all thanks to the line frost effect. Okay, so the line frost effect is cool and all, but besides being a neat little thing I can show in a video, can we actually use this for anything? Well, a couple of applications have already been discussed on the interwebs. You can sprinkle a bit of water on your frying pan to see if it's hot enough for the line frost effect to occur, thus making it hot enough for pancakes. This reaction video talks about how nuclear power plants need to be cooled with water without the line frost effect getting in the way, and this SciShow video touches on its applications in cooling electronics and inkjet printing. But to me, the most mind-blowing application of the line frost effect is powering Mars. So, you know how the line frost effect propels water on a serrated surface? Well, research done by Dr. Rodrigo Ledesma Aguilar and Dr. Gary Wells shows that if you put water in this little circular grooved contraption, it will continue to spin around and around. If you put dry ice in that contraption, it too will spin. Then, with the help of magnets and copper coils, boom! AC voltage. There's not a ton of dry ice on Earth, you know, compared to water and whatnot, but you know what has a lot of it? Mars. NASA's Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter has found that carbon dioxide is a naturally occurring element over on the red planet, so there would be an ample amount of dry ice, which is just frozen carbon dioxide. Combine that with a line frost effect, and we've got power stations, and thus colonies on Mars. So when we do get to the red planet, the line frost effect will be there every step of the way.
Thanks for watching. DFTBA, and explore on.
If you want to experiment with the line frost effect at home, here's what you'll need. A hot plate or pan or anything you can heat up to 220 degrees, water, a pipette, that's not necessary but helps, and of course, safety glasses. That brings us to today's phenomenal sponsor, NoCry. NoCry makes amazing safety glasses at an amazing price. These things are anti-fog, anti-scratch, anti-glare, lightweight, and they look great. Yeah, that rhymes. These are perfect for experimenting, DIY, and really any scenario where you need eye protection, or you just want to look really cool.
Looks like I just did a science.
I have the black and green ones, which are my personal favorite, but they also come in black and orange and white and pink. Click the link at the top of the description to check them out and grab a pair, and be sure to use code TECHNICALITY for 15% off your order. That's right, code TECHNICALITY for 15% off your entire order. Massive thank you to NoCry for sponsoring this episode and supporting Technicality. If you felt like this video added something to your day, it would help out a lot if you press that like button, subscribe if you haven't already, and check out this other physics experiment which I did, which involves disappearing balls. Ooh. Or check out this video I was talking about earlier where I do an experiment with heat and marshmallows and microwaves. Thank you to all my patrons, especially the ones on screen right now. See y'all next time.